The biggest brick and mortar book retailer, Barnes & Noble, making big changes that could impact what and how we all read. We're going to get into it with the Rocket Years author and our co-host today, Liz Segran. It is Wednesday, December 9th. Let's talk money with our friends. Welcome to the Money with Friends podcast. I am certified financial planner, Bobbi Rebell, host of the Financial Grownup podcast, coming to you from my very grown-up New York City kitchen.
And I'm Liz Segran. I am the author of The Rocket Years, How Your 20s Launched the Rest of Your Life, and a senior staff writer at Fast Company magazine. I'm coming to you from my airy attic office here outside of Boston.
Oh, we're all so jealous. It's a beautiful space. Here on Money with Friends, we talk about the latest personal finance headlines, add in the insights and wisdom of our fantastic cast of thought leaders like Rocket Years author Liz Segran. We mix in questions and comments from our money friends, and we leave you with a takeaway to make it your own. And Liz, I should also mention that you are a writer for Fast Company, and you also contribute to a number of other publications. What's been going on with all of your writing?
Oh, it's been wonderful, actually. I've been able to, you know, at the beginning of the crisis, everything was all COVID focused. You know, I was writing a ton of stories about masks and about about like the latest information we had about COVID, and it was just a lot, right? But I think what's really nice is that our minds are now able to process more than the immediate crisis, and we're beginning to think about the future. And I think that that's wonderful, because there are all of these like really fascinating questions, like, is the world going to become more sustainable after this pandemic, right? Are we going to change our behaviors in profound ways? Are we going to understand what really matters in society, like essential workers? Are we going to pay them more? There are all of these really important, fascinating questions, I think, that are looming ahead of us. And I think now we have the ability to sort of take them on. And I'm writing a ton of stories about kind of the future.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely have a change in mindset about what we prioritize and how we approach things. And I think given that, I'm not surprised that you wanted to talk about this story from the, I think it's from the Wall Street Journal, that we are going to be highlighting. Let's first see which one of our friends is going to bring us into that story.
Hey, what's good? This is Rich from Paychecks and Balances. And do you just like hanging out and chatting about the news? Well, that's why I tune in to Money with Friends.
All right. The headline reads, Barnes & Noble's new boss tries to save the chain and traditional bookselling. The struggling bookseller has laid off once powerful managers and overturned relationships with publishers in favor of a more local approach. And I believe this is written by Jeffrey Trachtenberg. I didn't have that written down, but I'm pretty sure that's who it is. Great writer. Right. Yeah, he's awesome. Okay. And the story, just to summarize it, basically it talks about the relatively new CEO, James Don, and how he's changing the strategy that has really made them so successful years ago, but now kind of tweaking it and kind of taking a more localized approach, because the way these bookstores worked is that the headquarters would kind of decide what everybody was getting. And maybe the local store owner knew, or manager of the local Barnes & Noble kind of knew his audience was really into one book, but was never going to be buying the other book. But they all got what the bosses at the headquarters said. So they didn't have much leverage to change anything. And there also was a system which can be good for some authors, but very hard for some other authors, where publishers, through various means, sometimes outright paying, but often just leverage of the fact that they have a lot of power because they have the top books, would manage to get the prominent placement in the brick and mortar store, in the brick and mortar stores. And that would, of course, influence what people saw, what was highlighted when they walked into these bookstores, and would influence what they chose to read. And so this kind of shakes that up a little, right, Liz?
Yeah, totally. And actually, I think an important point here is that this is actually happening throughout the retail industry. I've spent a lot of time studying the retail sector. It's one of the beats that I follow. And it's been interesting how over the last couple of years, Nordstrom and Sephora, which are large companies that have been used to having these very large footprint stores have been shifting and moving to smaller neighborhood stores where there's a smaller footprint and where the experience is very localized. And I think that part of it has to do with the product assortment there, like you're saying, but I think part of it also just has to do with creating a kind of more community vibe where local authors might be brought in, or, you know, you have, you know, very, very sort of like, it's more about the kind of the local community as well, and making it a place that people will want to stop by and come to in their neighborhood. And I think that strategy was working really well. I think the problem is that with COVID, there's just been this like major shakeup in retail. You know, a lot of stores shuttered for a significant amount of time, you know, early in the pandemic. And so that means that it's really hard for us to understand what the future is going to be, right? Because this was such an exceptional year. But I think the transition had been happening where, you know, people didn't want to go to big malls and big box stores that all looked the same, right? They wanted an experience that felt like they were going to their neighborhood. And so anyway, it's been happening across the retail sector.
So it was already happening to a large degree. How much do you think COVID-19 maybe accelerated this trend?
I think that a lot of the malls, as we've known, have already sort of been dying, right? Particularly second and third tier malls that were sort of like these big complexes, which had maybe a couple of flagship stores, like maybe there was like a Macy's in there, a JCPenney, and a bunch of other stores. But, you know, I think for a while, you know, those malls have just not been innovating very much. They haven't been, you know, fun, exciting places. They'd sort of like lost their appeal. And when people can buy everything online, there's no point in going to sort of like a boring, dull, poorly lit mall. Like it stopped having a purpose in society. On the other hand, there had been this desire for people to sort of like take walks in their neighborhood close to where they live, where they can maybe bump into a neighbor, that had been happening, right? And I think that what's going on with COVID is that the COVID is going to basically like be the last blow to the dying mall and the dying, you know, megaplex store. I think that's for sure. The question is whether as COVID, you know, passes, whether there's going to be a revitalization of Main Street, right? Like the little neighborhoods that we live in, whether there's going to be government funding, whether companies are going to be willing to invest in these smaller, you know, stores. I think that's left, you know, we still don't know what the recovery is going to look like. But I think that that's what people, I think consumers have desired that for a long time. Like, you know, basically it's really interesting. The malls basically emerged like about 50 years ago after the war. And before that, everybody had Main Street, right? They lived in their neighborhoods. They just went to their little town. You know, there were a couple of stores there. And it seems like that's where we're going back to. We're basically kind of going back to the future, right?
You know, Liz, I saw an interview recently with somebody, I believe it was on Small Business Saturday, and it was a small business owner saying everyone talks about supporting small businesses, but when it comes down to it, they're ordering on Amazon or they're ordering from another store or they're popping into a large retailer like a Best Buy or whatever it may be or Target. Do you think that people say that, and then when it comes down to their own personal choices at the end of the day, the easiest thing is to take out their phone and just click buy now?
Yeah, that's a really interesting point. And I think that when it comes down to it, consumers are still very money and value driven. They're very price and value driven, right? But here's the thing, like, the Main Street stores that are doing well are the ones that offer more than just a transaction. And so what do stores offer that you can't get online, right? And what they offer is a fun experience, a entertainment, really, right? Like I am willing to spend more on a product, you know, that, you know, if I can go into the store and discover new products for the first time, and they're displayed in a beautiful way, and I can take my daughter there on a Saturday, and it's a fun experience for the whole family. In that case, I'm totally willing to spend a little bit more, right? Because it was really wonderful. Or if the store offers some other thing, right? Like a community event, like, you know, we're talking about Barnes and Nobles here, right? I would be willing to go to my local Barnes & Noble store if they had like a cocktail hour or a fun event for kids, right? Those are the kinds of things that little stores can offer that will make it worth it. And there's also other trends that are happening. I think consumers really, really want to be able to get their products quickly. So if there's a way to order a product online, be able to pick it up in your local store very quickly. But then because you're going to that local store, they pull you in by like having a coffee shop there or some other thing. That's going to be the future, right? It's going to be being able to have the online experience, but also going into the store for things that don't have anything to do with the immediate act of transaction, right? It's going to be something else that will, you know, allow you to have a good experience in that store.
Yeah. Before we run out of time, you brought it back to Barnes & Noble. One of the things talked about in this Wall Street Journal article is the challenge of staffing, because if you want to give the power to these local stores to select what books or if it's a clothing store, what clothing to highlight, they talk about the fact that, you know, quote, having a teenager trying to shelve American history. So that's a challenge for a lot of these stores, is that you can't just hire someone that's not familiar with what you are selling. And especially for a bookstore, if you want to have that expertise, that might change the way that they staff the stores. And it's not always easy to find that person at what is often a minimum wage job. And that's totally that's part of the challenge, is if you're going to give the power to these little, to the local stores in a big chain, how do you then make sure those people can make those decisions? There's a reason many of those decisions were centralized, beyond the fact that, you know, the shipping and the logistics were easier. It also avoided having the wrong, you know, you don't have a situation where at a clothing store that's part of a chain, somebody who doesn't have the fashion sensibility that the brand wants to have doesn't put together a window display that is not on brand. I remember when I worked at a clothing store that was part of a chain in college, we would get very specific directions of exactly how the window should look. And that's why every single, you know, Ann Taylor Loft, every single Gap, every single Banana Republic looks exactly the same in the window display. I mean, one mannequin might be placed slightly differently, but they really look very uniform because they're being sent these directions so they don't mess up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I think that it's interesting because there was a time in American history when a retail job was a really solidly middle-class job where you could support a family on it. And it was because it required a certain level of skill, right? And knowledge of your audience and knowledge of the product. And as these malls have just become these like, or these big box stores have just become carbon copies of one another. I mean, as you're saying, one reason that they did that was because it was cheaper, right? And everything was cheaper, right? You could just centralize everything and then distribute it. And you could just hire people who didn't need a brain to just kind of follow the instructions. And I think that hopefully one good thing from this shift is that there's going to be an understanding that you need to hire like well-skilled, well-trained people who can make decisions about the local, about what the local community will want, right, in that particular store. And I think, you know, more broadly, coming out of this pandemic, we'll realize that these people are essential workers, right? Like people who work in our stores, people who help the local economy thrive, right? These are people worth paying. And so I think hopefully the desire for highly specialized retail workers who make the experience so much better for the consumer, coupled with a renewed understanding of how important retail workers are to society, those things together will result in, you know, better wages for these very important people in our communities.
Yeah, I do think there's, and I hope this continues on, a new sense of appreciation for the hard work that these frontline workers, even in our retail, do give to us. And I hope that continues beyond the pandemic. We're seeing them in a different way, mm-hmm. which I think is really important. Before we get to our takeaways, I do want to take a moment to talk to everybody about the new year and new ways about how to invest. We had a great year if you were invested in stocks, and that's wonderful, but you may be thinking, how can I diversify so that I don't have everything dependent only on the stock market, especially when the truth is a lot of things like fixed income that we've normally gone to are really not providing much of a return. So it's been tough. You can't, and frankly, the truth is we can't control where the markets are going to be. One thing that a lot of very wealthy people do is they control their risk by investing in different areas. And one area is blue chip art, totally unaffordable to you and I. But there is now a new way to get into the art market, and that is Masterworks. You can learn more about it at masterworks.io. But basically, what they do is they have experts that create a custom portfolio to meet our investment needs. You don't have to really do anything. They put it together. You basically are investing in a fraction of a piece of the art, and that way it is a fraction of the cost to you. You do have to have some qualifications, so you can learn more about that at masterworks.io. And they will give you more information. If you sign up with a promo code MWF, you can skip the huge, it's 25,000 person wait list. So again, that is masterworks.io. Make sure to use the code MWF and also learn more about the risks in their disclaimer area. You can get to that by masterworks.io/disclaimer, but definitely make sure to use our MWF code if you do go to learn more about Masterworks. Liz, it is time for takeaways. Your thoughts.
Okay, yes. Here's the takeaway. Retail is going through a major transformation, and I think it's a good thing. You know, the mall was not working for us for a long time, and I think the pandemic is going to cause that to accelerate, and I think the mall is going to not survive this pandemic, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. The key here is that there are lots of jobs that are going to be lost when that happens. And I think it's really crucial for companies to realize how important retail workers are. And as they shift their retail strategy and have more neighborhood type stores, it's crucial for them to hire, you know, experienced people and then pay them really well so that the customer has a great experience in those stores.
That is so well said. And I think that's going to be one of the new realizations as we move out of the pandemic is that these are frontline workers. These are essential workers, and that the right salesperson and the right staffing and the right decisions made by that staff can be the driver of in-store retail brick and mortar traffic. So I think that's a great point. You know, and as it goes to the bookstores, I mean, the truth is nothing they've tried before has really worked well. So this is really the last, possibly the last pushback to Amazon. The biggest challenge, of course, finding those staffers. So again, the local stores need to find the right staffers because the right choices were not coming from headquarters, and they need to make this work or they're not. I mean, they really have to make the big stores, I guess, like a Barnes & Noble, need to act like local stores, which is ironic because for years, the local stores needed to act more like the big stores.
Right. I think we're going to a moment where people really care about their community and they want to live, you know, close to where their stores are. They don't want to have to drive an hour away to go to the mall. They want the store to be part of their everyday life as they go get their coffee, they go to the grocery store, they want to be able to stop by their bookstore and their makeup store, right? This is the future.
Yeah, I think that's so well said. As for the future, you'll be back in another 4 weeks for your final couple shows with us as a Money with Friends co-host. Tell us what you're going to be up to and where people can stay in touch with you.
I'm so excited about the next month. There's going to be a lot of time at home in my pajamas, relaxing and preparing for the new year. But if you would love to read any of my stories, you can find me at Liz Segrin on all the socials, Twitter and Instagram. And I have a column at Fast Company magazine. And you can find my book, The Rocket Years, How Your 20s Launched the Rest of Your Life, at your local bookstore.
Yes. And I, by the way, The Rocket Years is on the Financial Grownup, my other podcast. It is on our recommended holiday reading list. So everyone, please listen to that episode of Financial Grownup. And if you have not already, pick up Liz's book. It is a great book to read over the holidays, even if you're not in your 20s. And it's also a great holiday gift. So I would highly suggest that and buy local if you can. And we understand if you don't. All sales are good. But if you can buy local, that's a bonus point. Bonus points for you. Liz, thank you so much as always for being part of this. Thank you for putting up with all of our technical glitches. We look forward to seeing you back here in a few weeks. And everyone, learn more about Liz and all of our amazing co-hosts and collaborators on our website, moneywithfriendspodcast.com. Please follow us on Instagram at moneyfriendspod. That is also our handle on Twitter. And of course, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Just search for Money with Friends on YouTube. Subscribe, set the alerts, and you can be part of the show as well. Oh, you know what? I did forget. We did ask our audience, where do you learn about new books? And you know what? They really said, most of them said podcasts. So there you go. That was the response. So stay close to Instagram so you can be part of those as well. Thanks, everyone. We will see you. Joe will be back tomorrow, I should say, with Farnoosh Shorabi. Thanks, everyone. Have a great day.
Bye.
This show's created and hosted by us, Joe Saul-Sehy and Bobbi Rebell, and it's edited and produced by Ashley Wall. Money with Friends is a product of Money with Friends LLC, copyright 2020.
For a list of the thought leaders who appear on the podcast and links to the stories discussed, head to our website, moneywithfriendspodcast.com. You can also check out our schedule for upcoming recording sessions so you can join us and be part of the show. Also, be sure to follow us on social media at Money Friends Pod on both Instagram and Twitter. Look out for our polls and quizzes. You could get a shout out on the show.
We're well worth following, we promise. As with anything, remember you shouldn't take advice from any of us or any other videos or podcasts without first talking to your financial advisor. These people on this episode, they're here for your and their entertainment purposes only.
I'm Bobbi.
I'm Joe.
We'll see you here back next time with another episode of Money with Friends.